What I wanted to show you today was a somewhat underdocumented feature of C sharp, which is a thing called dynamic overloading. Now, you're probably familiar with the dynamic keyword, came into C sharp in version 4, where we can just write something like this, dynamic d equals, and then we can put into that whatever type we like. So I could put in an integer, or say new and then some class, or I'm going to put in just a string. And the thing about dynamic is, in terms of compile time checking, all bets are off. So if I type d dot, then no IntelliSense support, not even the four basic object methods. And it's up to me to really know what's in there, know it's a string in this case, and to call the appropriate method. So if I do something like d dot to upper, then it's up to me to have spelt that correctly and to know there's a two upper there. And if I then run that, then we can see it correctly gives us that hello. But if I were to make the slightest spelling mistake, like get the case of the u wrong, and then we run it, we get a runtime error saying it doesn't know what two upper is. And so programming dynamics is very, very error prone, very, very cumbersome. It's kind of like programming in JavaScript, except with even less good IntelliSense support. The normal reasons we're given for having dynamic is it's if we want to interact with other languages that don't have the strong typing model that C sharp has. Or if we want to interact with, say, something like a COM component, which again doesn't have the same typing model. And if you need to do that, that's quite a good use of dynamic. But there are so many programs, for the vast majority of the time, we're not worrying about that. We're working entirely in a C sharp environment, and so you might ask the question, what is dynamic useful for? And that's what I wanted to show you here, because what I've got here is just a kind of cut down simulation of what we might want to do if we're writing some reporting software. So when writing a report, we've got all sorts of different data types for the different columns, and each of them might need some special processing. So I've just created four variables here of type string, int, double, and date time. And then I've put in four overloaded methods called process item. So they're all called process item, but they take the different types, int, double string, and date time, and then deal with them in their own particular way. So in this case, they're just saying what they're dealing with and then printing out the value. But you can see in the case of, say, a double, I'm doing it with two-digit precision. In the case of date time, I'm doing a two short date string. And then we can see down here, just using ordinary overloading, that that works fine. We can just call process item, and because these variables, v0 and so forth, are different types, they will be directed to the different overloads of process items. So when we run that, we'll see that's all working fine. Problem is, though, in reality, we're not actually going to have just these hard-coded values. We're probably going to have extracted the items we want to process in our report using something like reflection. And so what we're going to end up with is maybe just an array of objects called items, and then just put them straight in there, but we'd have got them from somewhere. And if we put those in, now we've got that loop, and we can forget about our individual process items. We would just have, say, a for each object O in items. And then what would be nice would be if we could just say process item O and get it to select the appropriate overload for us. But you can see it's giving us an error there because we're not allowed to do that, because normally overloading works purely on the basis of the static type, based on the information the compiler has available. And all the compiler has is this is an object, and there is no overload available for objects. We've done it for the four specific types, but nothing for object. Even if we put one in for object, it wouldn't be much use, because it then would behave in exactly the same way for all four types. In this sort of situation, the normal solution is to use polymorphism. So we have an abstract or a virtual method in the base class, and then override it to do the different processing for date times and doubles and so forth. But we can't do that here because we have no access to the base class. The only base class available is object. We can't rewrite that, so we can't add virtual methods. So what you'd normally see done to solve this is some kind of if else chain or switch statement to say if it's a string, call the string version, if it's an int, call the int version. And in fact, introduced in C sharp version 7 was quite a neat way of doing this, which is then called pattern matching. And so what we can actually do here, we could say for each object O in items, and then we could do a switch statement where we switch on O, and then this is the new bit in C sharp 7, we do case, and then we could say something like string S colon and then process item S and then a break. And the neat thing about that is that what happens is when we pass in our object O, if it's of type string, then we go to this case clause and then we take the variable and cast it into a string, which we put into that variable S. And then the process item now has a variable of a definite type string, and so it's going to select the correct one. So if we do that for all four of our cases, so for int I and then pass I in there, for double D and then pass D in there, and for date time DT and then pass DT in there, then we can see that those process items are all happy. And what's happening there is the process item is still being chosen at compile time with the normal overloading rules, because S, I, D, and DT have definite types, and the decision at runtime is done through the switch statement. And we can see now that if we run that, then that's going to work okay. That said, what we've got there is an example of something that's often referred to as a bad smell. So it's some code that, although it works perfectly well, just doesn't quite feel right. It looks a bit ugly and should be avoided. In this particular case, what we have is a switch statement, which is switching on the basis of type. And that's something that since the early days of object-oriented programming, we've known to avoid, because those sorts of things should be replaced by use of polymorphism and a virtual method. Except, of course, we've just said we can't use virtual methods here because we haven't got access to the base class. And so, although we've got a perfectly good excuse for the bad smell, we still haven't avoided it. More specifically, the reason that this is not great code is because it's not particularly extensible. Or at least when we do want to extend it, we have to do it in two ways. So suppose we wanted to add another type in here. I'll just put it straight in here. Let's put in a decimal. That obviously doesn't match anything in the case statement. So what we have to do is actually make two changes. We have to introduce a new overload taking a decimal. And then let's again just do that with number of decimal places. But then we've also got to remember to put an extra clause in our switch statement so that it will pick up on a decimal. So having done that, that will work, but we'll get our decimal to three decimal places there. But it's a bit clunky because we've got to make the modification in two places. And although here it may be fairly obvious, in reality, the process item methods could be in a completely separate assembly from the switch statement. And so you'd be moving around having to change things. So it's not ideal. It'll work okay, but it's not great for maintenance. The alternative, though, is we can use this idea of dynamic overloading. And that's much, much simpler. So if we go back to the original solution, which didn't work, but if we change that, if we make that dynamic, then we're not getting any errors, because what we've now done is said, well, O is a dynamic type. Remember, that means the compiler doesn't attempt to do anything with it. And so now the decision as to which of the overloads to be called is going to be done at runtime. So now when we run that, we can see that we've got all five of them working without any kind of switch statement or if else chain or anything like that. So that's a rather more elegant way to solve the problem, which in terms of extensibility simply means you need to add a new process item whenever you've got a new type that you want to deal with. Though, of course, it will still give you runtime errors if you try it on an item for which you haven't provided a process item. But that would happen either way. That would happen with the switch statement as well. One last thing to say on that, always something to bear in mind, is performance. I've done a quick bit of benchmarking. I won't show you the details now. But essentially, doing the dynamic approach is substantially slower than doing it with the switch and the pattern matching. It came to about an order of magnitude difference, which is a fair amount. But then, you know, it's pros and cons. If you're doing this really intensively, obviously performance is a bigger issue. But if you're doing it on just an occasional basis, then maybe the elegance of the code and the maintainability is a better issue for you. But whether you want to use it or not, it's just useful to know this is another way we can make use of dynamic. And also worth mentioning, as well as working for overloading, this also works for generic instantiation. So normally generic instantiation, the type you instantiate for is chosen at compile time, but if you change it to a dynamic, it'll be deferred to a runtime decision. As ever, any questions, pop them in the comments below, and I hope you found that helpful.